Well, hi everybody. Welcome to our ESP webinar. We're so glad that you could join us today. My name is Allison O'Connor. If we haven't met, I am the horticulture specialist up in Larimer County, and I'm also the current ESP Zeta chapter president. If you're not sure what ESP is, don't worry, you'll hear a little bit more about it. But basically, we're the extension professional organization. So we focus instead of content of working in 4-H or community development, we're really focused on you as the extension professional. We would love to have you join us. We're always seeking new members, but we are thrilled that you're with us today, whether or not you're an ESP member, and you can always hit me up for more information later. I do want to get to our amazing presentation today, which is all about changing your habits, because we were just discussing how we all feel a little bit pulled in about 47 different directions. And I think this is very common for what we are facing today in our jobs and everything else. And so we have an incredible group of people joining us from all across the United States. I will briefly introduce them, and then our five speakers will each do a portion. So we have Travis West with The Ohio State University, go Bucks. We have Barb Dunn Swanson. She is from Iowa State University, two of my schools. I love this. Mollie Toppe from West Virginia University, Katie Ahern from Oregon State, and Tyrone Gentry from the University of Kentucky. So without further ado, I believe that Travis is going to start us off. And if you need to leave us, this webinar is being recorded and you can catch it later. So thanks for joining us, and take it away.
Hey, thanks, Allison. Hopefully you can see the screen. Yes, thumbs up. Okay. So thanks, Allison, for the invite. So Allison reached out to me. So this is a presentation a little bit adapted from what we delivered at Extension Leadership Conference, but really thinking about balancing a little bit about balancing work and life, why that's important, but really more about habits and how we sort of take small steps and develop those habits. So the ESP national team, those of us that are here, I'll have a little bit to share to sort of kick off thinking about habits and how we use those to potentially manage our time or improve our mental health so that we're not running 700 different directions. So again, it's not something that's going to happen tomorrow, and definitely takes a little bit of time and a little bit of diligent process to do that. So I think I'm going to kick it over to Barb and Molly.
And Molly, are you going to start, or do you need me to start? I think Molly does.
I can go for it. Thank you, Barb and Travis. Hi, everybody. Mollie Toppe in West Virginia. I'm the Northeast Region VP for ESP, and I'm a 4-H agent, which means June is my crazy month. So if you are out there doing 4-H camp, activities, fairs, animals, all kinds of things, I hope you can get a little nugget of wisdom from this presentation and take some of it to heart. We do want to credit Dr. Janet E. Fox, who's from the University of Tennessee. Much of this work that you are going to see about balancing our work and life comes from Dr. Fox. So just know that we are taking her work and just resharing it with you. So I will say that a lot of what you may hear from Barb and myself is probably not new information to you. We know this as extension professionals. It's just a good reminder that many of us consider ourselves workaholics. Almost 50% of Americans consider themselves workaholics. And some of the statistics that go along with that, I have them here over to the side. 40% say that if they are not at work, they might be thinking about work up to 4 hours of the day. So there's our time that we're not at work, but we're still thinking about it. And many people give extra time to work that they're not being paid for. So above their 37.5 or 40 hours, they are workaholics. Because of that, we lack that work-life balance. 66% of Americans say that they feel this. And 77 of full-time U.S. employees experience burnout. I bet we've all felt it at one point or another. It looks different for different folks. But maybe at different times of the year. As extension professionals, we feel that. At different stages in life, we feel that. But just feeling like we are overwhelmed, we're giving too much time at work, and it's hard to balance other aspects of our lives. So a term that Dr. Fox brings up is role conflict, which, again, I bet you can appreciate what this means, even if you've never heard that terminology before. It's when parts of our lives overlap and conflict. So, for instance, our roles at work and our roles with our families, sometimes we can't balance those two things. They're overlapping too much. We can't give ourselves enough time to our family because of work obligations or vice versa. Role overload happens when we just lack the resources to do what we need to do, to perform all of our roles. And then ambiguity, I think this is a great thing for us to think about, especially if we are managing people. We may have felt that ourselves as employees, but let's take it a step further, thinking about managing volunteers or folks that we work with. It's very hard to complete tasks and to feel comfortable in our jobs when we don't understand what the expectations are. And that causes a lot of stress, confusion, if it's ambiguous, and we don't know what is expected of us. It just adds to that burnout possibility and our work-life stress.
Thanks, Mollie. And so then we want to say to ourselves, well, what kind of strategies do I have that can help me with this work-life balance? First off, time management. We have to get clear on maybe when do we work the best? How can we get more control? So am I an early morning riser and do I get my best work done then? Or am I better in the afternoon? Once I figure out when I work best and when I have the most energy, that can help me with time management. I also need to build in time for planning and evaluating. Think about the work you do as an extension professional. Oftentimes we find ourselves going from project to project to project to project. We don't even get the first set of boxes from the first project unloaded before we pick up the next set and head right back out the door. That leaves us little time for that planning and evaluation. So we got to give ourselves time for that. Also, you know what? We need brain breaks, don't we? We have to take some time to let our mind rest and relax. We've got to have that. It's good for our balance. And distractions can be really a limiting factor for us. It can get in the way of doing our best work. So think about what your distractions look like and how can you limit some of those. Maybe it's just even where you work. Is there a place where you can get away and get some quiet time so that you can feel good about the work you're doing? And above all, Janet reminds us that if we can get good sleep, if we can eat healthy, and if we can get some good exercise, that is going to be helpful. Another thing we can really help us is to have some realistic expectations of what our work life can look like. We are the ones that control our clock. Oftentimes we think other people control it, but we do have control of it. And one of the things that we know is we all have the same amount of time in the day. But we put stuff on our calendar and then we wonder why we're burnt out or we have so many other people's expectations that fill our bucket. We have to say, what do I value most? And if I can get clear on my values, I can then be more in control of what my outcomes look like. But I got to know what I value first. So if I'm a 4-H professional like Mollie, do I value those kids having good decision-making skills, having good opportunities to get outside and be a part of a camping experience? What do I value? And then put my energy toward those values. If I work in ag and natural resources, do I value helping farmers look at their sustainability inputs? Well, then I've got to give some time and look and meet with farmers and hear their perspective. Once I know what my values are, I can give time and attention to those things. I also need to really think about my expectations. Do I put unrealistic expectations on myself or are other people also expecting more than what I can do. I have to be a good communicator. I have to let people know what my values are and then have expectations that are realistic. And I have to quiet my fear, because often those unrealistic expectations are born from fear. You know, we might fear that we don't have the right answers. The farmer's going to ask me something, I'm not going to know what to say. The 4-H professionals are going to be out and about, and parents are going to have questions for me. And what if I just don't have the answer for them right now? Maybe I'm working in human development and family studies or family consumer sciences, and people are trying to reduce the amount of salt in their diet. And they ask me a question and I think, oh my goodness, I don't think I'm going to know what to say. Well, you know what I have to do? I have to say, you know what? I've got other colleagues I want to pass this question along to. I have to quiet my fear for sure. And finally, I have to think about positive thinking and listen to my self-talk. Our brain listens to what we tell it. So I have to make sure that my dialogue inside my head and reminding myself to be positive. Sure, there are negative things that can come up during a day's time, but try to reframe how I look at a situation and be as positive as I can. We know the health benefits of positive thinking: increased lifespan, lower rates of depression, lower levels of distress, greater resistance to the common cold. They're all there on the slide. All those things can be helpful to us as extension professionals. And with that, I think I'm going to turn it over to Katie.
Thank you, Mollie and Barb. So my name's Katie Ahern. I am the West Coast Regional Vice President for ESP, ending my term this end of September. We look forward to seeing everybody in Billings. And so today we're going to start our atomic habit. We're going to start building a habit that helps us accomplish tasks and develop these time management skills that'll aid us in this balance that we're trying to achieve with our work and our daily lives. I'm going to put I'm going to put a link in the chat right now. And this is a link to a workbook. Atomic Habits is a book by James Clear. And so all this information will be something that is all coming out of this book. It's a book. He had published a book. He also published a workbook. What I put in chat is like his free version of a workbook. I signed up for it. You can also sign up for emails to help you kind of daily. I think there's 3 emails a week, and it helps you process an atomic habit that you would like to do. So lots of varieties of ways that you can gain this information. So atomic habits are anchored on small changes that lead to incredible results over time. It's a systems-focused mindset that brings better results than a goal-focused mindset. So habits are not a finish line to be crossed, but they're a lifestyle to be lived. There are all sorts of myths about how long it takes to build a new habit. I'm sure we have heard them all. Is it 30 days? Is it 66 days? But the truth is, there's nothing about time passing that magically forms a habit. Habits are created based on repetition and frequency, not by the clock ticking. So, are you ready to make a habit stick? We want to choose a habit that sticks. Most people choose a habit they want to build and start considering the outcomes they want to achieve. For example, I want to lose weight. However, the alternative is to build an identity-based habit, starting focusing on who we wish to become, not what we wish to achieve. And you can see the arrows going. This is more of an identity-based habit. It goes from the identity to your outcomes. So today we're going to choose an atomic habit to practice moving forward. If you can open up the link that I put in chat, and it'll bring up the workbook. You can download it right now if you would like to, or you can fill it in and save it to your computer after we're done today. And if you go to page 14 of our workbook, you will come up with this, this sheet to fill out. So we're going to choose this atomic habit to practice moving forward for today. This can be a new habit to help ease the general life overload of work and things we have going on at home. So you want to ask yourself, who is the type of person that can get the outcome I want? So what would a healthy person do? What would a productive person do? What would an X person do? And that is your desired identity for your habit. And we're going to be working towards that each day to build our desired identity. So this way we can determine the habit you should focus on. So after you have your desired identity, then you'll write the habit that you're going to focus on that reinforces this identity. So for example, if I wanted to write a book, I would focus on becoming the type of person who writes every day. So we're going to take a minute to fill in this page and put in chat if you're having difficulty finding the worksheet or the page to write in. And once you write in your desired identity and the habit you'll be focusing on, if you're willing, please share in chat. And Travis is going to put music on for 1 minute while we have some time to think about what type of person you want to be and what habit you're going to work on that reinforces your desired identity.
Pour myself a cup of ambition and yawn and stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets, the traffic starts jumping. Folks like me on the job from 9 to 5. Working 9 to 5.
That was quick, isn't it?
That was a really fast minute. Thanks, Travis. Does everybody have the type of person, their desired identity, and the habit that will reinforce their identity? Any questions? Anything that right. Well, keep that in mind as we move forward. Oh, I want to be an early riser too, Barb. I want to be a person who's known to get that gets up early, for sure. So when you're trying to build this new habit, it's easy to start too big. When you think about changes you want to make, your excitement and motivation can convince you to do too much too soon. I think we've all been there. I want to run a marathon. I'm going to start running 26 miles today. So have you all heard of start small, take baby steps? Well, the one place to start when building our new habit would be choosing a habit that is easy as possible to perform. And we call this the 2-minute version, the 2-minute rule. So the 2-minute rule states when you start a new habit, it should take less than 2 minutes to do on a daily basis. So for example, if I want to be known as a marathon runner, and I put in my habit of I'm going to run 3 miles each day to get going for my 2-minute rule, I might start by putting on my shoes and walking and running around the block. Might be my 2-minute rule. I'm really synthesizing and taking baby steps to build my habit. So in step one, we chose the habit that will cast votes on our identity. And now we're going to take that habit and we're going to scale it down to 2 minutes. So I'm going to give you, and this can be really hard to do. So Travis is going to start the music again for 1 minute while you think about how you're going to make your habit that you want to develop your time and make it a 2-minute rule. And if you're willing, just put it in chat.
I'm the same boat with a lot of your friends, waiting for the day your ship will come in and the tide's gonna turn and it's all gonna roll your way. Working 9 to 5.
Mollie, I like yours that says, put your phone in a place for less distraction. Quiet guitar time. Excellent.
Show it.
Oh, give yourself 5 to 10 minutes for mindfulness. Absolutely.
Google might not be the best for everyone, but for business owners, it is.
Thanks, Travis. So maybe 5 or 10 minutes a day of quiet time you might start off with just 2 minutes a day, finding quiet time in your day. And I missed the last one. It's so hard for me. Yeah. 5 a.m. club. Wow. That's amazing. All right, everyone. So now, and now that we have our 2-minute rule, the question really is, how do we successfully insert the new habit into our daily lives? And we call this process implementation intention. Basically, we're asking ourselves, what is the ideal time and location to complete our habit? Because when we find the ideal time and the right location, this will lead us to success. So on page 16 of our workbook, we're going to reach our success with our implementation intention plan. And this is the simplest way to apply the strategy to get your habit is to fill out this sentence, which will be, I am going to do what behavior, at what time, and where. So I'm going to make my green smoothie at 7 a.m. at 7 a.m. in my kitchen. So I'm being really purposeful of where my 2-minute rule is going to land in my day so that I will make sure that I am successful each and every day in implementing my 2-minute rule. So on page 16 of your workbook, which on a piece of paper, your implementation plan of where you're going to have your 2-minute version of your habit, and that's going to reinforce your identity. And now you're going to have a clear and specific implementation intention for adding this into your daily routine. This one can be kind of hard to really think about where this lands for success for you in your daily life. So we'll do music for one more minute while we really think about this. And please share in chat if you're willing.
A little song I wrote, you might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now.
Your mileage, Tyrone, is a big hit. Clearly, as a community, we all struggle with our mileage reports. So cheers, cheers. All right. Thank you for this portion. And now I am going to pass it on to Tyrone to continue to talk about atomic habits. And you'll be on, and Tyrone will be on page 17 of the workbook. Thank you.
Thank you, Katie. My name is Tyrone. I am a 4-H agent, first year on the board. So I'm excited to be a part of the presentation and excited to be a part of this amazing team. We've been working to get this habit identified and then to get it refined and narrowed down into something that is really specific that we can manage. But even sometimes when that's going on, we still have chaos. And how can we go about optimizing this refinement even more? And one of those big areas that can make a habit successful or also a failure is the environmental constraints. So what can we do environmentally to help make our habit a higher probability of sticking for us? So there are lots of things that we can do. One of those things is, you know, like, I wish my office looked like that, but it doesn't. One of the things I have tried to do in terms of habits and having an office that looks like that is always on Friday before I go home, I try to clean off my office desk. You know, that's the kind of that environment I want to have when I come back on Monday to start my day. But depending on your habits, so there could be lots of other environmental small changes that we can do to make our habits successful. You know, if you want to drink more water in your water bottle, you know, put a reminder on your water bottle. I've seen a person who had a black mark on their water bottle, and I asked what that line was for. And they told me, that's my reminder. That's my environmental reminder when my water bottle gets half empty to fill it back up so I never get caught with a low bottle of water. So environmentally, what can you do? A minute while ago, I put on there about my habits. I'm terrible with my travel, writing down my mileage. So my environmental habits remind me to write down my mileage when I get in the office vehicle. When my phone connects to the car radio, it pops up a reminder on my phone to track my mileage. And all I have to do is hit a single button and it gets my location. And then I can type in my mileage. That's my environmental reminder for me. So to make your habit successful, is there something in your environment that you can tweak to give you a better probability of being successful with this new habit? Some more examples. You know, if you want to walk more and exercise more, have your exercise clothes laid out the night before, so they're there looking at you when you wake up the next morning. So what can you do? We're going to give you another minute and some more music to ponder. And if you would like to share, we'd love to see some of those environmental tweaks that you're thinking about for your habit in the chat.
Ooh, be happy. Ooh, don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy.
Happy.
I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I need to have it. Awesome. So some wonderful ideas in there. You know, alarms on our phone, I think, is an amazing trigger, an easy trigger. And I'll catch myself laying in bed, voice messaging to set these alarms. So lots of technology oftentimes can be the tweaks that we need to give our habits that little extra edge they need to be successful. You know, this one, this little graph here reminds me how much I did not like graphs in economics. But what it's telling us here is something that's very important as we think about habits. There's going to be this valley of disappointment, and that's kind of that arching circle there under that straight line going left to right. That valley of disappointment. You know, when we first start out, some of these habits, they may be hard for us to repeat on that regular basis, to create that momentum, to create that reoccurring natural instinct to do them, that valley of disappointment. But if you see that curve over a small period of time, if we repeatedly make that effort to do those little 2-minute tweaks that we've been talking about, that curve starts to increase. And it starts to increase exponentially. So, you know, the benefits will come and they will come much quicker. We just have to be dedicated. We have to create that environment that allows us to be successful. We have to have those habits targeted and narrowed down so they're not overwhelming and they're not discouraging just from the nature of what we've created. But the valley of disappointment, it will end. And we will be happy. We will be successful if we keep trying. So how are we going to So another thing that we can do to help us be successful is called this temptation bundling. And it's a strategy where we can stick with a habit when our motivation begins to fail. So, you know, there might be comes a time where we're starting to wane, we're not being as effective as we hope. And temptation bundling is tying that habit that we want to do to another habit that we're already doing. You know, and as I was thinking about this, I kind of use this thought process in here to stop a bad habit in my life. I used to use a lot of tobacco when I was in school, and I wanted high speed internet. And my wife said, we can't afford it. But she said, if you give up that tobacco, we'll get high speed internet. So I can remember as a newlywed couple, we were making decisions and the trade was easy. I didn't miss tobacco at all because I could go home and do that thing that I enjoy. So this temptation bundling is taking a habit that you already do. I love to listen to podcasts. And in our original presentation, Katie had a picture of her vacuuming, you know, and the idea was I can listen to my favorite podcast when I'm trying to do this new habit. So it's kind of rewarding yourself with that good habits that you already have as you try to implement and continually reinforce the new habit. So for this slide in this moment here, think about the habit that you want to do and the habit that you're going to reward yourself that you currently are doing when you do the new habit. So the habit that you would like to reward yourself with when you are completing your habit, the new habit you're working on.
Don't worry. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile, but don't worry, be happy. Cause when you're worried, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy, don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
Awesome. So back to my habits are all related to my travel reports, which I don't like. I love music. I listen to music all the time, no matter where I am. And that's partly why the reminder on my phone when I'm in my truck to pop up before I pull out captures my mileage easy, because I want to listen to my music and I've got to get past that to start my music. But when I'm at the office working on my monthly reports, I listen to a lot of music. So I reward myself by listening to music at work only when I'm working on reports. So that's the motivation that gets me in my report mind, because I know I get to listen to music when I'm at work. But some other wonderful exceptions, wonderful examples in there as well. You know, only watch your favorite TV show when you're preparing a healthy meals, or only eat their favorite snack when they're studying French. Katie's going to learn French. You know, so try to find a way that you can reward yourself with something that is already a habit for you, something that you enjoy, something that is easy. If you tie them together, that temptation bundling, it reinforces your likelihood that you'll be successful. Another way that people help reinforce their habit is by tracking it. Lots of different ways that you can track your habits. And in that book, that manual that you can get online for free, you know, there is an example in here. And, you know, these should be, you know, really specific, and you're trying here to create these chains. You know, you don't want to break that chain. You want to keep the sequence going, and sometimes it will happen, you know, and in these days when it does happen, you know, I try to tell myself, let's don't let it happen twice in a row to get back on that right track. You know, so on these, you want to be, when you're listing your habit tracker examples here, you want to be very specific, you know, like, I record my set in my workout journal after I finish my gym. So being in specific here again, it allows you to check those days when you've got that habit that you've got narrowed down, and you can check them off the times that you do them. So your next, I think your last screen, your last writing. Nope, not yet. Okay. So the completion here, though, is the cue. You want to get, you know, continually checking them off. And by being that consistency, that's how you develop those habits. As you know, as I think Katie or Barb or Molly, one of y'all mentioned earlier, you know, it's not a set number of days or a set number of times. It's that consistency, that repetition that helps create this habit in our lives. You know, whenever this happens, you know, when we do mess up, and we do, I will. I sure won't drink near enough water at summer camp next week, and I know I'll regret it. But when it messes up, I try to tell myself, don't let it happen twice. Don't let it happen twice in a row. Now, as we move on now to our next slide there, Travis, when we start out building these habits, a new habit, you know, it's kind of new. You know, when things are new, it's novel and it's interesting. But over time, though, that habit will become routine. They become learned, the outcomes become expected, and they just become natural. You know, we don't have to write down the habits. We don't have to check them off a list. We just get up. I just get up and brush my teeth every morning. I don't know when that habit started, but it happened a long time ago. So as your new habit, though, becomes natural and second nature to you, you know, that's what we're looking for here. Sometimes they may become boring, but this can be the first symptom that it's time to graduate your habit to the next level. So, you know, in terms of these building these steps, one of the reading examples was, you know, I'd love to read more. I just don't rarely have the time, I tell myself. You know, and maybe I start off reading, you know, a chapter a night before I go to bed. And maybe at a point in time that kind of gets boring for me. Maybe I start reading two chapters or trying to do something a little bit more. So this mastering a field in that bottom graph there is it's taking steps. In each of these steps, we're narrowing down that habit to a very finite, measurable thing that we can do in that short 2-minute span. And once we've got that mastered, we can up our game, take it to the next level, or add another step of complexity to it. A small step that we can continually mastering the field, mastering the habit, and making ourselves better. Now, when we always start by mastering that first 2 minutes of the smallest behavior and then advancing it up through intermediate, the next steps. You know, once you've mastered lacing up your running shoes and stepping out the door, graduate to running around the block. That's kind of what I would have to do. Start with putting on my running shoes for this week, and we'll try running next week. But it's about growing in that 2-minute mastery and breaking it down in small chunks that we can handle. Okay. Next screen there. There we go. All of these activities and these resources have come from Dr. James Clear and his book, Atomic Habits. There's the website also that was shared in the chat where you can get the workbook. The emails, they're amazing. I highly recommend you sign up for those. They're short, they're sweet, and they don't wear you out. And, you know, it's just the small tidbits that we need to keep us reinforced, to keep us engaged, to keep us working on our habits. You can also snap that QR code there with your phone, and it'll take you where you can sign up for those as well. Travis, are you wrapping us up?
Yes, I think so. So I think sort of a wrap up, we'll be happy to take questions, comments, input. But when you think about habits, those sort of baby steps, right? And it's not one of those things, like I said at the beginning, that any of us are professing to be experts at, right? It's hard work, and it takes some dedication to do that. But sort of going back to the beginning when Katie talked about being very specific, right? Really getting down to what is the one thing that I want to tackle in the next 6 months, right? Maybe, or it's for the next year, you know, sort of breaking it down and getting that habit. So the one thing that when we present the CLC that I talked about was like just putting on my shoes and walking to the basement and touching the treadmill, right? If I could do that for 2 weeks, then maybe at week three, I would actually get on the treadmill, right? So just really thinking about breaking those down into steps, because sometimes it's like, well, I'd really like to do this, but it's really hard to figure out how to go from doing what I'm doing now to nothing to something that seems sort of insurmountable, especially given our workload with an extension. So, and we will be happy to take questions or comments. If you have them, feel free to unmute, or if you want to drop them in the chat, that's an option as well.
Travis, This is Barb, and I was just thinking about what you were just saying there about lacing on the shoes and then getting down to the treadmill. Again, think back to what you value. Do you value the time that you feel good and have additional energy if you do, that is your reminder then why you get on that treadmill. Because when you get done, you feel like you've got a little bit more energy and you have those endorphins flowing and it feels good. So you can connect it back to your values. Think clearly about what it is you want for yourself. We don't often invest enough time in ourselves and who we are. We're so busy caring for everybody else that we forget to take care of ourselves. And a lot of this that we're talking about today, setting habits and balancing and putting ourselves first, that's some of the first steps in self-care is just, you know, putting yourself first and trying to think about what you need and what you value. You do those things first and you'll come out on ahead as an extension professional, but it starts with you. You've got to be 100% first.
So I would like to know of our speakers today, have you successfully created a habit like Tyrone? Do you do your travel reports now in a timely manner?
More timely. I am better about writing down my miles. So when I get in my truck, my phone beeps. It won't play music until I type in my miles on my phone. It logs into my calendar. So I am much, much, much better at collecting that information on the front end instead of always Googling where I drove to get my mileage. I'm better at doing them at my computer, listening to music. It will make me do my reports. I need to up my game on that one a little more.
Sounds like you just need Travis to feed you the music and then we'll all do it together.
If that would help, I would. Reports are due in 2 weeks.
Are there other questions from the group? I do want to say before we head out or before we take more questions, thank you so much to all of you for coming today. Thank you to our speakers. This was fantastic. I just signed up for the 30 Days to Better Habits. I'm really excited to receive those emails. And just for this information, I think it's so valuable. And we sometimes just get overwhelmed and lose sight of what we can do and what we can control. And I think it was you, Barb, who said you control your calendar and that you are exactly right. I do. I'm the one who commits and I do control that. So that was really helpful. So, okay. Well, with that, thank you again to our speakers for today. Thank you, everybody, for joining. And look for our next ESP webinar coming up on professional development. And I hope everybody has a great afternoon. Thanks so much.